Let's start our today's topic. Our today's topic is DNA. We were discussing DNA in the last lecture as well. In the last lecture, I showed you physical structure of DNA. Now you know DNA is a double helical structure. It is formed of two helices. Those two helices, they are antiparallel in nature. That means they are parallel, but their direction is opposite. Those two DNA helices, they are joined to each other. Please don't make noise. Those two DNA helices, they are joined to each other by hydrogen bonds between their nitrogenous bases. So you have seen that physical structure of DNA in the last lecture. Now today I will try to make you understand how these two helices of the DNA, how they are formed. Each DNA helix is actually a polynucleotide chain. So a polynucleotide chain is formed by the combination of many nucleotides. So how these nucleotides join, I will try to show you that in the diagram, right? So first, a nucleotide, you know it is formed of a nitrogenous base, a pentose sugar, and a phosphoric acid. So nucleotides, they are formed of nitrogenous bases, pentose sugars, and phosphoric acid. So let us draw one nucleotide first. Let us make one nucleotide first. This is a nucleotide. It is having a nitrogenous base, a pentose sugar, this is a nitrogenous base, suppose it is adenine. This is pentose sugar. So adenine plus pentose sugar, it forms the nucleoside adenosine. Then this adenosine, it combines with the phosphoric acid molecule. So it is joined with a phosphoric acid molecule here. And that phosphoric acid molecule is joined to another nitrogenous base and pentose sugar. There will be thymine here. It will be joined to another phosphoric acid molecule. So one nucleotide joins with another nucleotide, right? Similarly, another nucleotide will join here. And in this way, a polynucleotide chain will be formed. This is one polynucleotide chain of the DNA, right? So this is nitrogenous base adenine. This is pentose sugar. When nitrogenous base combines with the pentose sugar, what do they form? When nitrogenous base combines with pentose sugar, they form nucleoside. So adenine plus pentose sugar, they combine, they form adenosine. Then it joins with a phosphoric acid molecule, it forms a nucleotide, adenosine monophosphate, or we call it adenylic acid. Then one nucleotide joins with another nucleotide. Similarly, it will join with another nucleotide. That will join with another nucleotide. So in this way, a chain of nucleotides will be formed. This chain of nucleotides is known as a polynucleotide chain. So one polynucleotide chain is formed. This is one polynucleotide chain, right? It has got the direction. What is its direction? 3 prime, 5 prime. What do you understand by 3 prime, 5 prime? At carbon third position, this is carbon first of pentose sugar, carbon second, carbon third. This is carbon 4, carbon 5. At carbon third position of pentose sugar, there is a hydroxyl group, right? So this hydroxyl group is lying free. It is not joined with another nucleotide, like in this, right? Is another pentose sugar, carbon second, carbon third, carbon four, carbon five, right? Here in this pentose sugar, carbon third, it is joined with another nucleotide. But in this nucleotide, carbon third position is free. It is not joined with another nucleotide. So this carbon third position, where hydroxyl group is lying, this is known as 3 prime. And at the top of this polynucleotide chain, it is carbon 5, which is having phosphoryl group attached to it. which is not joined with another nucleotide. So this last nucleotide having phosphoryl group and this carbon 5 position, this is known as 5' end, right? So this is one polynucleotide chain. Similarly, opposite to it will be another polynucleotide chain. I will show you like this. Can draw the diagram like this. So this is another polynucleotide chain, right? It has got direction like this. This is the 3' end, this is the 5'. Carbon 1, carbon 2, carbon 3, carbon 4, carbon 5. So this is just 3' end having hydroxyl group at carbon 3. This is just 5' end having phosphoryl group at just carbon 5, right? So these two chains, this is one polynucleotide chain, this is another polynucleotide chain. You can see they are parallel to each other, but opposite in direction. The direction of this chain is from 3' to 5'. Direction of this chain is from 3' to 5'. So they are parallel to each other, but they are opposite in direction. So this pentose sugar plus phosphoric acid, pentose sugar phosphoric acid, it forms sugar phosphate backbone. It forms sugar phosphate backbone. Pentose sugar plus phosphoric acid. It forms sugar phosphate backbone. In between them, this is another sugar phosphate backbone. This is another sugar phosphate backbone. Sugar phosphate backbone. Right? Pentose sugar phosphoric acid, pentose sugar phosphoric acid. This is another sugar phosphate backbone. In between them are lying nitrogenous bases. This is nitrogenous base, nitrogenous base, nitrogenous base, nitrogenous base. These are the nitrogenous bases. Nitrogenous bases, right? So how these two polynucleotide chains are joined to each other? They are joined to each other by hydrogen bonds between their nitrogenous bases. Between adenine and thymine, there are two hydrogen bonds. Two hydrogen bonds between adenine and thymine. And between cytosine and guanine, there will be three hydrogen bonds. So these bonds are the hydrogen bonds. They are hydrogen bonds. These hydrogen bonds between nitrogenous bases, they keep these two polynucleotide chains joined together. So in this way, they form a long double helical structure known as DNA. So now you know DNA is having two helices. Each helix is a sugar phosphate backbone. This is sugar, this is phosphate, sugar phosphate. So this becomes the sugar phosphate backbone. Again here, sugar phosphate, another sugar phosphate backbone. Then these two sugar phosphate backbones, they are attached to nitrogenous bases. They have attached to them nitrogenous bases. This is adenine, thymine. Similarly, there may be cytosine, guanine, right? So these are the nitrogenous bases. And these nitrogenous bases are joined to each other by hydrogen bonds. So in this way, sugar phosphate backbones, they are attached to each other through hydrogen bonds between their nitrogenous bases. So in this way, they give rise to a double helical structure known as DNA. So this is the chemical structure of DNA. This is the chemical structure of DNA. I hope now you understand what is 3' ended, what is 5'. 3' ended, what is 5'. I hope you have understood what is antiparallel fashion. This is the direction of one polynucleotide chain. This is the direction of another polynucleotide chain. So this polynucleotide chain is in 3'5' direction. It is opposite polynucleotide chain is in 3'5' direction. They are opposite in direction. So that this we call as antiparallel fashion, right? So this is the chemical structure of DNA, right?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, you know DNA, which is occurring naturally in living organisms, is known as which type of DNA? The DNA which naturally occurs in living organisms is, I have told you, DNA is of different types. Some DNA is synthesized in the laboratory. DNA is also synthesized in the laboratory. But the DNA which we find naturally in living organisms is known as? In last lecture, I have told you. There are different types of DNA. One is known as ADNA. Another is known as BDNA. Another is known as cDNA. Another is known as dDNA. Another is known as zDNA. The DNA which is naturally found in living organisms is the bDNA. The DNA which is found in our body cells is bDNA. Naturally occurring DNA is bDNA. This ADNA, it has got 11 base pairs. What are base pairs? It has got 11 base pairs per peach. What is a peach? In the last lecture, we discussed what is a peach. The distance between two shallow grooves is known as one peach. And one peach represents one complete turn of DNA. In one peach, in ADNA, there are 11 base pairs. In BDNA, which is naturally occurring DNA, in this our DNA, there are 10 base pairs per peach. In naturally occurring DNA, there are 10 base pairs per peach, as I showed, showed you in this physical model of DNA. Then in cDNA, there are 9 base pairs per peach. In dDNA, there are only 8 base pairs per peach. So the naturally occurring DNA is bDNA. Naturally occurring DNA is bDNA. So in our DNA, there are 10 base pairs per peach. ADNA, cDNA, dDNA, zDNA, they can be synthesized in the laboratory. They have been synthesized in the laboratory. ADNA has got 11 base pairs per peach. cDNA has got 9 base pairs per peach. dDNA has got 8 base pairs per peach. And zDNA, it has got 12 base pairs per peach. A, B, C and D DNA. They are right-handed helices. A, B, and C DNA. A, B, C, and D DNA. They are right-handed helices. While as Z DNA, it is a left-handed helix. Right? So these are different DNA which can be found. The naturally occurring DNA is bDNA. It has got 10 base pairs per peach. ADNA, cDNA, dDNA, and zDNA, they can be synthesized in the laboratory. They have been synthesized in the laboratory. These ADNA, it contains 11 base pairs. cDNA contains 9 base pairs. dDNA contains 8 base pairs. And zDNA contains 12 base pairs per peach. A, B, C, dDNA, they are right-handed helices. I hope you understand what is right-handed helix and left-handed helix. So they are right-handed helices, while as zDNA is a left-handed helix, right? How much DNA is present inside the nucleus of a human cell in 46 chromosomes? there is approximately 2 meters. 2 meters of DNA in 46 chromosomes. Of human cell. There is approximately 2 meters of DNA. Approximately there is 2 meters of DNA in 46 chromosomes of human cell. And what is the diameter of the nucleus of human cell? The diameter, average diameter of nucleus of human cell. It is just 10 microns. How can this approximately 2 meter DNA can be contained in a nucleus of 10 microns? I hope you remember it is because of coiling and supercoiling. This DNA, it is in the form of a coiled coil, right? First it gets coiled around those nucleosomes, then nucleosomes coil, they form solenoid coil, then solenoid coil, they form the chromatin, then chromatin coils that forms chromatid, then chromatid further coils that forms the chromosome. So in this way, this approximately 2 meters of DNA, it is adjusted in the nucleus of a human cell, right? So that is all about DNA, right? Now after DNA, we are going to discuss about other nucleic acids. After DNA, we are going to discuss about other nucleic acids. Which is another type of nucleic acid? DNA is a nucleic acid. Can you tell me which is the another nucleic acid? Good. So RNA, it is another form of nucleic acid. You know the full form of RNA is ribonucleic acid. Why we call it as ribonucleic acid? Why it is known as ribonucleic acid? DNA was known as deoxyribonucleic acid. Why RNA is known as ribonucleic acid? You have forgotten. Because it contains ribose sugar. In DNA there is deoxyribose sugar, right? So for the presence of ribose sugar in it, it is known as ribonucleic acid. And DNA was known as deoxyribonucleic acid, right? In contrast to DNA, this RNA, it is a single polynucleotide chain. It is a single polynucleotide chain. DNA was a double polynucleotide chain. This RNA, it is a single polynucleotide chain. There is only one polynucleotide chain in RNA. There are different types of RNA, but all of them have only a single polynucleotide chain. In DNA, there were two polynucleotide chains, right? So this RNA is a single polynucleotide chain. Where from this RNA comes? RNA is present in the cell. Where from this RNA comes in the cell? This RNA, it is formed from DNA. The information for formation of RNA, the information for synthesis of RNA, that is stored within DNA. That is stored within DNA. So this RNA is formed from DNA. The information in DNA is transcribed. It is transcribed to form RNA. There are three different types of RNA. One is known as ribosomal RNA, rRNA. Another form is known as messenger RNA, mRNA. And another form of RNA is known as tRNA, transfer RNA. So all the three forms of RNA, they are formed from DNA. Through a process of transcription, right? So they are transcribed from, their information is copied from DNA. The information for synthesis of RNA, it is stored in DNA, right? So rRNA, it is formed from DNA by the help of an RNA polymerase. For copying this information for forming RNA, we need some enzymes. Those enzymes which copy the information from DNA to form these RNA, they are known as RNA polymerase, right? So for formation of RNA, rRNA, from DNA, we require an enzyme that is known as RNA polymerase. Okay. RNA polymerase first. So So ribosomal RNA is formed from DNA by the help of an enzyme known as RNA polymerase first. Messenger RNA is formed from DNA by the help of an enzyme known as RNA polymerase second. And transfer RNA is formed from DNA by the help of an enzyme known as RNA polymerase third. So these three types of RNA, they are formed from DNA by a process known as transcription. And for this transcription process, there are three different enzymes. RNA polymerase first, it is involved in formation of ribosomal RNA from DNA. RNA polymerase second, it is involved in formation of messenger RNA from DNA. And RNA polymerase third, it is involved in formation of transfer RNA from DNA, right? So all these RNAs, they are together present in the cytoplasm of cell. They are together present in the cytoplasm of the cell. Ribosomal RNA, it forms approximately 80% of total RNA content of the cell. Ribosomal RNA forms, it is the most abundant type of RNA in the cytoplasm of cell. Ribosomal RNA, it forms approximately 80% of total RNA content of cell. Messenger RNA, it forms some 3-5% of total RNA content of the cell. Messenger RNA is the least abundant RNA. It is not in greater quantity in the cytoplasm of cell. Messenger RNA just forms 3-5% of total RNA content of cell. And transfer RNA, it forms some 10-20% of total RNA content of the cell. So which one of these RNAs is most abundant in the cytoplasm of the cell? So the most abundant RNA in the cytoplasm of the cell is ribosomal RNA, rRNA, right? It forms 80% of the total RNA content of the cell. Messenger RNA, it forms 3-5% of the total RNA content of the cell. And transfer RNA, it forms just 10 to 20% of the total RNA content of the cell. So these RNAs, they are formed from DNA. The information for the formation of these RNA, it is stored in DNA. This information is copied from DNA by a process known as transcription. And for this transcription of this information, we require some RNA polymerase enzymes. RNA polymerase 1 is involved in formation of ribosomal RNA. RNA polymerase 2 forms messenger RNA. And RNA polymerase 3 is involved in the formation of transfer RNA. So these are three different types of RNAs which are found within the cytoplasm of the cell. So these are the nucleic acids, right? Now we will discuss these RNAs one by one. We will discuss them one by one. So first we will discuss messenger RNA. This messenger RNA is the most important of these RNA types, although they are all important. But for protein synthesis, messenger RNA is most important. So first we will discuss the structure of messenger RNA. Now you know each of these RNAs is a single polynucleotide chain. It is not a double helical like DNA. So we will first see the messenger RNA, mRNA. Right? So this messenger RNA molecule, it is again a single polynucleotide chain. It is a single polynucleotide chain, right? It starts from its 5' end and ends at the 3' end. So this single polynucleotide chain, it is a linear polynucleotide chain. What is a linear chain? It is a linear polynucleotide chain. I hope you understand what is a linear chain. Linear chain is a chain which has got two free ends, right? It is a situated chain having two free ends. So it has got one free end known as 5' end, another free end known as 3' end, right? Like DNA, the ends are 5', 3' ends. They are similar. What do you understand by 5' end? Which carbon will be having phosphoryl group at 5' end? 5' end is the end of the polynucleotide chain where carbon 5 is having phosphoryl group. 3 prime end is the end of polynucleotide chain, where carbon second has got hydroxyl group, right? So this is the linear polynucleotide chain. It has got 5 prime end and 3 prime end. The diagrammatic representation of this messenger RNA is somewhat like this. We represent the messenger RNA diagrammatic like this. This is the diagrammatic representation. This is the diagrammatic representation of messenger RNA. So this is a messenger RNA molecule. It has got a 5 prime end here. It has got a 3 prime end here. So it is a single polynucleotide chain. So it is first polynucleotide. It is first nucleotide. It is known as methylated guanine cap. So it is first nucleotide is guanine nucleotide. It is first nucleotide is guanine nucleotide. But this guanine nucleotide, it is protected by methyl groups. These methyl groups, they protect it from the action of nucleases. Nucleases are the enzymes which degrade, which digest the nucleic esters, right? To protect it from the action of nucleases, it is first nucleotide, guanine nucleotide, is covered by protective methyl groups. So for that reason, this first nucleotide is known as methylated guanine cap. This first nucleotide is present at the 5 prime end. Then there is a region which is known as 5 prime UTR. This region is known as 5 prime UTR from this end to this end. This region of messenger RNA is known as 5 prime UTR. UTR stands for untranslated region. Untranslated region. UTR stands for untranslated region, right? So in this region of the messenger RNA, there are some 10 to 100 nucleotides. There are some 10 to 100 nucleotides. These nucleotides, they will be not translated. They will not be translated in the process of protein synthesis. Information for synthesis of proteins that is contained in messenger RNA. So these nucleotides, these 10 to 100 nucleotides which are present in 5 prime UTR, these nucleotides are not translated in the process of protein synthesis. That is why we call it as untranslated region. That is why we call it as 5 prime untranslated region. Because this untranslated region, it is present on the 5 prime end of the messenger RNA. Then this 5 prime UTR, it is followed by coding region. This is the coding region of RNA, messenger RNA. Coding region. What is contained in this coding region? In this coding region, there are many nucleotides which are arranged in a set of 3 nucleotides. So, set of 3 nucleotides, they form one codon. They form one codon. Suppose here we have got adenine nucleotide, uridine nucleotide, guanine nucleotide, right? So, a set of 3 nucleotides, AUG, it will serve as one codon, right? And this first codon, which is present in the coding region, this is known as initiation codon. It is known as initiation codon. It is known as initiation codon, right? So, coding region starts with a codon known as initiation codon. This initiation codon is mostly present in the messenger RNA in the form of AUG. AUG codes for methionine amino acid. It codes for methionine amino acid, right? So which is the insertion codon? So insertion codon is AUG. This is the first codon which is present in coding region, right? Then similarly, there may be some other codons. There may be some other codons for different amino acids. We have got 20 amino acids. Those 20 amino acids, they are represented by 61 codons. They are represented by 61 codons. So the remaining codons are present. They follow the AUG. So every codon is a set of 3 nucleotides. Adenine nucleotide, guanine nucleotide. They form one codon. Similarly, there may be another codon. Suppose it may be AAG. It will serve as another codon. GAA, it will serve as another codon. So similarly, there are many other codons in this coding region. They will code for the amino acids. Then at the end of this coding region, there is a codon known as stop codon. There is a codon known as stop codon. This stop codon, it may be UAG, it may be UGA or UAG, UGA or it may be UAA, right? It may be UAA. So these three codons, they are known as stop codons. They are known as stop codons. Any one of them is present at the end of this coding region. Any one of them is present at the end of coding region. Either it will be UAG or it will be UGA or it will be UAA. Any one of them can be present at this stop codon, right? At the end of this coding region. So when this messenger RNA joins a ribosome, it starts protein synthesis from insertion codon. It starts protein synthesis from insertion codon, and it starts protein synthesis, polypeptide chain synthesis at stop codon. At stop codon, right? So this region of the messenger RNA, this is known as coding region, and it starts with insertion codon and ends at stop codon. Then this is followed by 3' UTR. There is another untranslated region known as 3' UTR. This 3' UTR, it may possess some 50 to 150 untranslated nucleotides. How many untranslated nucleotides were present in 5' UTR? 10 to 100. In 3' UTR, there may be some 50 to 150 nucleotides which will not be translated. Only this coding region is translated by the ribosomes. Only coding region is translated by ribosome. A polypeptide chain is formed from the information contained in this coding region. Then this coding region is followed by 3' UTR having some 50 to 150 nucleotides which will not be translated. Then this is formed, followed by a poly A tail. Having some 200 to 250 nucleotides. Most of these nucleotides are adenine nucleotides. That is why we call it as poly A tail. Most of these nucleotides are adenine nucleotides. Poly A tail. Poly means many. A means adenine. Tail. So there are some 200 to 250 nucleotides. Most of them are adenine nucleotides. That is why we call it as poly A tail. And this poly A tail, it marks the end of messenger RNA molecule, right? So a messenger RNA molecule is a linear polynucleotide chain. It starts from 5' end and ends at 3' end. At 5' end, its first nucleotide is methylated guanine nucleotide. We call it as methylated guanine cap, because this nucleotide is protected by protective methyl groups, which protect it from the action of nucleases. They don't allow this to be quickly degraded. Then this methylated guanine cap, which is followed by 5' UTR, there are some 10 to 100 nucleotides, which are not translated in the process of protein synthesis. That is why we call it as 5' UTR. UTR stands for untranslated region. It is present on 5' end, that is why we call it as 5' UTR. Then this 5' UTR, it is followed by coding region. In this coding region, there are codons for formation of polypeptide chain, right? So there is information for the synthesis of a polypeptide chain. So a polypeptide chain will be synthesized according to the information contained in this coding region. This coding region, it starts with a codon known as insertion codon. Most of the times, this insertion codon is AUG, right? In some prokaryotes, this AUG may be replaced by another codon that is known as GUG, right? In prokaryotes, Please don't make noise. In prokaryotes, this AUG may be replaced by another codon known as GUG. Or sometimes it may be replaced by another codon known as UUG. GUG is code word for valine, and UUG is code word for leucine. Right? Most of the times, the insertion codon is AUG. But sometimes in prokaryotes, you may find GUG as insertion codon, or you may find UUG as insertion codon. GUG is code word for valine, UUG is code word for leucine amino acid, right? Then this insertion codon is followed by other codons, according to which the amino acids will be joined to form a polypeptide chain. Then at the end of this coding region, there is a stop codon. Usually, stop codon may be UAG, UGA, or UAA. They may be, any one of them may be the stop codon. All of them are not present together there. All of them are not present together there. Only one of them is present at the end. So, insertion codon marks the start of polypeptide chain and stop codon marks the end of polypeptide chain. It is followed by 3' UTR, formula of 50 to 150 nucleotides, which will not be translated. Then at the end, there is poly-A-tail, formula of some 200 to 250 nucleotides, which mostly contain adenine nucleotides. That is why we call it as poly-A-tail. So, that is the structure of messenger RNA. I think you have understood it completely. So, it is a single polynucleotide chain. And this is its diagrammatic representation. Right? So, this is section for today. Thank you for being with me.